they've known. For the, I don't know, one of them, the last Wednesday night, we closed out and, over in the book of First Corinthians, I had, read a verse to us there, verse 31, First Corinthians 12. And, what we were talking about, the good gifts that God gives. And, you know, what we do with them, he gives unto us the Holy Ghost. And how we use those gifts and how he tells us, you know, what we should do. And, but then, as he's talking about the gifts, he said in verse 31 of 1 Corinthians 12, he said, "The covet earneth the best gifts, yet show I unto you a more excellent way." And then you have 1 Corinthians 13. And he speaks about love in that passage. And I'm going to read a little of it again just to remind us of how great the love of God is. I mean, it says, "As though I speak with the tongues of men and angels, have not charity, which is God's love, I am become a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I can remove mountains and have not charity, I'm nothing." In other words, we could do a lot of glorious things, it says. But he said that the love of God is not in it. He said it says nothing, or it's a sounding brass or tinkling cymbal. "And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor," that's a wonderful thing. "And though I give my body to be burned, if I have not charity, it profits me nothing." So he said this then about this love that God is, that he's speaking about it. He said, "Love suffers long and is kind. Love envies not." Well, I'm going to tell you, that's what love to do. "Love vaunteth not itself," or does not raise itself up, is not puffed up. "Love does not behave itself unseemly, and love does not seek her own. Love is not easily provoked, and love thinketh no evil." Don't think bad of love. "Love rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. Love will bear all things." That thing is just always been something that's far beyond the natural man. "Love believeth all things. Love hopeth all things. Love will endure all things. Love never fails." That's what he says to me. To me, and I've heard a lot of people call this the love chapter here, 1 Corinthians 13. But it's something how Paul said in the midst of all of what he's talking, because he's dealing with the gifts here. He'll go back into chapter 14 there, which wasn't in chapter when he wrote the letter. But he goes right on back in talking about the spiritual gifts and the difference they make in the body of Christ and all that he's accomplished. But in the midst of all that, he wanted to talk about love. He said, "I want to show you a more excellent way." And I thought, boy, that's amazing. You know, of course, it tells us, we see it in the scriptures. John spoke about it a lot in 1 John, how he said simply, point blank, God is love. How he just gives us the scriptures. John does a lot of times with his writing. But what I want us to think about here tonight, in talking about this more excellent way, is to begin here in the book of James chapter 5, verses 19 and 20. And he's speaking to him, we know, here in James. We know he's the practical preacher, you could say. You know, he says all the time in his writings, if you really are what you say you are, then he says, show me, you might say. But the thing is, he tells them here, he said, "Brethren, if any of you do err from the truth," in other words, he says, sometimes we get led astray or led away. We talked about it some when we were talking about that life with the guilt. We sometimes find ourselves in situations, you know, that we did not want to be in. I'll tell you how a guy by the name of Ellicott, who was, that wrote a commentary, said, as the leading away was an act prompted by the devil, so the bringing home the service of God. He said, in other words, sometimes there's those that err from the truth, and one converting, let him know that he which converteth the sinner from the error of his way shall save a soul from death and shall hide a multitude of sins. Now, he's the same one here, James is, that had written in the first chapter here, in this letter he wrote, he had said that when lust hath conceived, it brings forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, brings forth death. So here, he's saying that if there is among the believers someone that errs from the truth, that finds themselves, you know, that fall out of the way, he said if we convert that one, in other words, help them to turn back, hallelujah, unto the Lord, he said, you deliver a soul from death. In other words, sin, when it's finished, brings forth death and destruction in the life. It happens in believers' lives. That's what we see happen a lot of times. It goes, that's why Paul wrote the letters a lot of times when he did, to exhort us and to warn us of this. And he said, if we do that, in essence, and I know when we say it this way, shall hide a multitude of sins, he's really not saying it's not necessarily the fact of hiding and remember, but the point is, it's covered, hallelujah, that oftentimes those things will not have a condition. They'll not come to pass if someone, hallelujah, takes the time, praise God, to go and to help someone who's fallen out of the way to be set back in the way. So he says that to believers. Now, the reason I read what I did in 1 Corinthians 13, because I want you to see what he says in 1 Peter 4 and 8. Now, Peter, you know, he's a pretty stout preacher, if you remember about him. He don't cut no corners much. He talks about what he feels about false teachers and false preachers, and he lets us know where we stand. So here's what he said, though, when he told them. Now, it's in verse 8, but I'll just read verse 7. He said, the end of all things is at hand. Be ye therefore sober and watch unto prayer. And above all things, now he said, above all things, the end of these, the day, hallelujah, we're in the last days. And Peter says, here we are. He said, I'm trying to tell you, have a sober mind. In other words, think right, hallelujah. Think spiritually. Have this mind in you that's in Christ Jesus. And watch unto prayer. Above all things, though, he said, have fervent charity among your servants. It's kind of like we were talking about the other day. Jesus said to Mary, there's a lot of neat things that's needed, but the one thing that is very necessary. And he said, that's got to in Jesus, hear his words. Here he said, now among believers, among the household of faith, he said, what I'd say to you above all things, have this love among your savers. It's important. It's important that God's people love one another. I mean, when you think about it, and I have at times thought about how Jesus said several times to his followers, who had their conflicts and problems in life. He said, they're going to know you by the love you have for one another. And he could have said a lot of things that would have been, but he said it was the love. So here he's telling them, have this fervent love among yourselves. Why? Because love or charity shall cover the multitude of sins. It's what gives us or enables us to forgive each other. To be able, praise God, that when we get offended or we get hurt, it takes the love of God. I mean, there's not anything else that will suffice. I know it myself, I can't. I've done found that out too many times in my life. I'll tell you, I could get a hold of one, a grudge, and be mad about something and hang to it till the cows come home. Or the old saying is, till it thunders, you know, or we turn it loose of it. But if the love of God's in our hearts, he said, this love will cover the multitude of sins. Now, in saying that, he tells us this over in the book of Proverbs, chapter 10. And Shane, if you will, put verse 11 up on the board. The mouth of a righteous man, he says, said is a well of life. In other words, he speaks those things through life. But he said, violence covereth the mouth of the wicked. Then in verse 12, he says, hatred stirs up strife, but love goes all sin. And it's something to me how that, you know, it's just a different thing. It's not based on my emotional state. So sometimes, and one lady told me today, I met a woman just sitting in the waiting room. She got to talking to me. She's 83 years old. She started out and she's still singing in the choir, in church or something. But she was talking about some of these things, and I thought about how that, you know, love, hallelujah, what a difference it makes. And so some of the things she told me about her life and all that had taken place. And to have fervent charity in our midst, to be able, as the writer Proverbs said, to know that love will cover all sins, it enables us, praise God, to be what we need to be for one another. He went on to say then in Galatians chapter 6, this is how we're going to accomplish being to do what we need to do in Galatians chapter 6, verse 1. He tells us this, let me turn around, then I got used to looking in the back. Galatians 6 and 1 tells me, he said, the one I've used a lot, he said, brethren, if a person be overtaken in a fault, you which are spiritual, you restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. Now here's what he said in verse 2. And this is kind of the way I base what we're looking at tonight. Bear ye one another's burdens. If you do that, he says you have fulfilled the law of Christ. Committee it was to love the Lord thy God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself. You know, they came asking Jesus, what is it? That's what he told them. So he tells us here to be able to do this, and this is the way that the Bible that I have, I don't know what kind it was, but the Hebrew Greek Key Study Bible, says at the top of chapter 6, it calls it the practice of love. In other words, it's love in action. It enables us that when we see a fellow believer, someone that professes Christ, we can't necessarily know all the time if somebody knows the Lord or not. God, the Bible says the Lord knows his own. But he says if we see such a one in a state like this, if we're in the place we need to be, he said, ye which are spiritual, in the love of God, and we manifest it in my life, then I'm able to help in the restoration of that believer, as we had read earlier, how that love would cover the multitude of sin. How that when I find somebody, you know, to be reminded of this truth, and listen, boy, I tell you, to help somebody back in the way, praise God. He said, what it does for the household of faith. And so he tells us here, you know, he reminds us, if we're able to do that, then we can bear one another's burdens. We can fulfill the law of Christ. He said this also in 1 Timothy 4, chapter 4, and verse 16, that I thought was good. 1 Timothy 4, 16. Paul's writing here to Timothy, we know that. And he's told him in one of the scriptures we used last week, not to neglect, not to give to sin, but in verse 14. But then he tells him in verse 16, he says, take heed unto thyself, and unto the doctrine, or the word of God, the instructions of God. Continue in thee. Now he's given an exhortation that we all need, hallelujah, that we, you know, be careful that, as we said Sunday, not to fall from our own steadfastness. Take heed unto thyself. Be willing to look in the mirror of God's word, as James tells us to, and to be able to correct the things that we, that God shows us that we need to deal with in our life. He said, do that. He said, also, take heed unto the instruction of the word of God, the doctrine, and then continue them. Here's what he gives a reason for this, more than just because that's what I ought to do. But he said, in doing this, thou shalt both save thyself, in other words, you'll deliver yourself from many hurtful lusts and desires of this old world, and them that hear thee. And I thought about it, that's something now that, you know, consider that, if we might be able, hallelujah, to lead somebody else to Jesus, just by the very fact that, glory to God, we're just trying to, hallelujah, remember that, you know, we got to deal with our own selves. We have to try to walk where God would have us to walk. We got to listen to the Word of God and follow after it to continue in that manner. That not only will it deliver us and keep us, hallelujah, but it might be that somebody else will see Jesus and they'll be saved. See, it takes God's love in our life and our hearts to do these things. I thought about how in the beginning there, how he instructs us, I'll show unto you a more excellent way. Let God's love be manifested. Then he says this in 1 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 19. Paul makes a statement to me that is not necessarily easy to, in verse 19, to necessarily do. Paul says this. He said, though I be free from all men. Now, in saying that, he's not, I don't think, trying to say I don't have any responsibilities, but in the essence, he said, my salvation is based upon what Christ has done, my faith in that word. But he says, though I be free from all men, yet have I made myself servant unto all for this reason, that I might gain the Lord. You see, there's a motivation here that you see in Paul's life, you know, that moves him, not just the fact that I don't want everybody else to say, well, look at there at him, he's supposed to be a Christian and what he's doing, or, you know, the fact that we want to be sure we're esteemed in the eyes of other people. He says, one of the things that really moves me and motivates me is my love for other folks, my love for sin, for lost people, for believers that sometimes, you know, find themselves out of the way. He said, I made myself servant and all that I might gain the more. He said, unto the Jews who had come to the place, now they hated Paul for the most part. Because, boy, I mean, you know, he crossed up. They said he just did away with the law of Moses, even though he didn't, you know, because he pointed to Jesus. But he said, unto the Jews I became as a Jew that I might gain the Jews. To them that are under the law as under the law. He said at times, you know, that Paul sacrificed his liberty, sometimes as a believer, that he could have done certain things because of the grace of God now, that he could do. Why? Because he did not want to offend or cause one of them to fall out of the way. That's, you know, there's something that motivates him to sacrifice this way. There's something that makes him willing. Just as it was Jesus. I mean, my goodness, think about, here he is, the God of glory. And you got sinful man who really don't appreciate anything you do for him. But Jesus, who you know sin, said, I'll become sin for them that they might be made the righteousness of God. He, what a love. And so it's manifested. Paul here is talking about it. He said, to them that are without law, as without law. In other words, he could go among the Gentile people. And he didn't get mad over every little thing that wasn't done according to Jewish law. He can live among them, minister to them. But there's something that has to be there to keep us from just unwillingly. We might old saying it, I got to bite hard down on this piece of wood. I just can't bear to deal with these folks. But Paul had a love in him that was really unusual to me. And I mean that we can have as believers. We have access to. But he said, I did this that I might gain them that are without law. And what he said is that they would come to know Jesus. He said, to the weak became I as weak, that I might gain the weak. I am made all things to all people, that I might by all means save some. He said, I'm willing. So there's got to be a motivation. But Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 13. He teased one to give us a little idea of how unbelievable God's love is. How that there's a lot of fellas out here that blows a lot of big horns, but they didn't have the love of God in them. And he said, it ain't done them a little bit good. Nobody did. But he said, I tell you, if God's love's in there, he said, this is what God's love does. This is how great it is. How great his love is in believing. And so Paul said, if there's any way I can, he said, I want to be able, praise God, to lead others to Christ. And then he tells us in Luke, I thought about this, and that passage of scripture, and Shane is in chapter 10, verses 25 through 37, but it's that story we've heard many times. Jesus tells about this Samaritan that comes by and finds a man that's been beaten and cast into the ditch and left for dead. How that there's a priest and a by chance there came a certain priest that way, and when he saw he passed on the other side. And likewise a Levite, he was at the place too, and he passed on the other side. But search of there. As he journeyed, came by, and he had compassion. And so ultimately in the end of this, Jesus tells us at the end of this, there are one of the stories that he's telling. He asks a question, who was neighbor? Which is one of the things when they love our neighbors themselves. He simply said to them, after they confess and want to show mercy, go and do thou likewise. Jesus didn't come, hallelujah, to those that were already, he's what if advocated in a great position, he came to those that were sick. And so he's the good, you know, in that respect, you see that picture, hallelujah, that he has. And I'm going to tell you then, this is always for me in Romans chapter 9. Then in verse 1 there, down from verse 3, is what he says. I don't know if I even have that on there, Shane. But Romans chapter 9. He said, I say the truth in Christ. I lie not, my conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost. Already wanted me to emphasize now this. He wanted to be sure that folks know I'm not just that I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart, for I could wish that myself. Now, for me, this is as near to God's love as I believe that a person can be. Were a curse from Christ for my brethren, my kinsmen, according to the flesh. And what he went on and said later in this same book, he said in chapter 10, of verse 1. He said, brethren, my heart's desire, prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. That was his desire. You know, here's Jesus. He dies. The Bible says, and I believe it's in Romans 5, that we read some of those things he says about us. He said, when we were yet without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. He said that he commended his love in us toward us while we were yet sinners. While we were his enemies, he reconciled us unto God. That's the manifestation of Christ loving people that hated him. And here Paul is, who, as I said, for me is just, I mean, because to say what he said there, and he emphasized it. He said, I'm telling you, my conscience bears me witness in the Holy Ghost. This heaviness and sorrows in my heart is about my kinsmen, my people, according to the flesh is concerned. He said, because they had all the promises of God. If you'll read on that, and you'll see it. They had it all. I mean, they were God's chosen people. He said, but they threw it away. He said, that they could, God just saved them. Now, he knew that ultimately God's coming and tells us that in chapter 11. And God's going to bring them home. He's out here talking about these Jews that he's meeting, that he's coming across, and he's trying to tell them about Jesus. He goes to the throne, he'll go to the Old Testament, and he'll start showing them Jesus. He'll let them know, no matter, they reject him. At times he gets upset. He did. He got that. He said, listen, I'm done with you. I'm going to the Gentiles, but you know what? The love that is in Paul. Come back and try try one, he's gonna try again. He's gonna share the gospel with them, even when they make him mad as old sin as a wet set. Because they just bullheaded sometimes. But Paul knew he'd been that way on the road to Damascus. Jesus said, you know, why persecute that? Paul said, I'm chief of sinners, I don't. And so I believe he was a human being. He got upset sometimes. He got things got to him when people didn't do like they ought to. But the love of God is strong. It would continue to bring you back. That's why I think somebody like old Jesse Norris would tell you it might be 40 or 50 years to come to the first. Or like somebody, you know, because I know some people thought, well, Sister Brigham's crazy. She's still trying to pray for that daughter of hers. And she had been in such a picture. The Spirit told me, Gerald, sir, it might not be in my life. God. And so she just didn't pray. Even when you got hurt, even when you got offended, even when you got betrayed, whoever it is, I'm not, we don't always, I wish I could say we were always, you know, really that love of God's going to pour out of us and you ain't never going to find us in the wrong frame of mind. But all of us that live for somebody else, better not say that, but I believe that. But it's what we should be striving for. You see, that we could see, like Paul said, I show unto you a more excellent way. This is the best way. Now, there are some other things that we do and we need to do, in spite of the fact we may not even measure up in that area of love. But he does say, this is the best way. Let love be the root in our hearts. And our acquaintances, the in the cross, among the believers, is something we need to do. The difference it makes. Number one thing, we're all, if Paul, who had such an experience with Christ on the road to Damascus, that sometimes he could get discouraged and disheartened about it, but you know, he said to Timothy there toward the end of his life, he said, they all forsake him. Luke's still here. So we have that. God help us. We need, because love does, it covers so many of the problems. I think a lot of times everybody in the world has to hear all the troubles in the church. You know why? Because love ain't killing all the sin. You fired up mad and they call the law. And that's come to you, the law of the cross. You know, we've read plenty of, I'm sure, news articles. All down at church, such and such, and it was tied up and it's going to it. God help us. We're going to be that way. We're going to do our prayer request. So you've got prayer requests. No, amen. Jesus.
Amen. Remember all the special favor. She's had a real sore throat and she thinks they're going to take her toxins.
Amen.
Amen.
Did they move some of her bunch, Johnny? Another prayer request. He's always got something to add on to it. He's pretty good. Well, I guess the Lord did say, you see, you be wise, harmless the dove, but wise the serpent. You have to use both sides. Amen.
Remember us and our families.
Amen, sister. That's pretty good. Let's remember the church as a whole. And of course, we know there's a lot of folks right now. It's a difficult circumstance. I'll tell you what. Grow, praying for one another, hold each other up for the Lord. Let's remember our nation, surely our military and their families right now, everything that's going on. For Israel, praying for the peace of Jerusalem. Let's remember, continue to pray for those in Afghanistan, and remember those in Ukraine. That's a terrible situation. Call up for the Lord. Because I just read it for a layup for me. Remember those in prisons and jails, nursing homes and hospitals, our first responders, our president, our leaders, the Gideon's ministry, the Lighthouse ministry, the Little Bitty Wrestling, the cash from the Highway Shepherd. Be praying for our youth and teachers. They're working towards some things. They're getting some stuff together for the young folks. It's going to be working on some little different mission things and stuff to do. So please be praying for them. God tell me that the way you're going to have a good crowd tonight, so they get them. We thank God. I pray that God bless that and use that. You know, going forward, Jesus. Please be praying for Miss Shirley, Miss Annette, Brother John, the nursing home, the one of her family. And Parker, her family. And for Betty and Augie and their family, for the Mikes and Ruby and their family, Emily Helms and family, for T.L. and Sue, Curry. I hadn't talked to them here in the last several days, but I know T.L. was the last time I talked to them, she was trying to get the strength. Now, where do you know he had?
She said that he was doing a little better.
Hopefully, he's meaning of this. For Jacob Becht and his family, the young man from Freeport, the young gang, please keep praying for Lewis and Daniel. In our prayers, please hold them up. For Colin and Brendan and their family, Tony and Carol and their family. He told me that he really believed Hannah had peace. Just remember that Sister Ann Daniels and her family, Bruce, later had unspoken requests. Lucius had unspoken requests. I'm praying for Truman and Martha. And that's David Sunday, but he said he didn't know exactly what her situation was. But she, like I said before, she'd been fallen. So for Roger had an unspoken request. They had asked prayer again for Megan Burge, who battles this crawl. So she had a flare up on the ground. So, yes, that's a prayer for her. Little Shane and his family, Shalia, their family, Josh, his family, her family, for the family. We appreciate prayer, praying for her, for us. And the family's brother, Jimmy Ewell, who's going to have to have the ablation. So, they couldn't get him in until sometime in
April.
They got giving medication right now to try to keep his heart rate. So, we appreciate your prayers for him. And Jessica, they are and their family. They had unspoken requests for their baby. Is your brother Edward good?
He's doing better. He still has some.
Cash and her family, Richard, the rest of the family, they got there. Jerry and Terry and their family. Little Rush, and praying for him. Little Tegan. Also, I don't know, has anybody heard any more about Melvin Road? Somebody mentioned it.
Ryan, you live there behind me. You heard that, but
he had a monitor that would happen this morning. Sharon, your sister, doing better?
She is doing better. But that one is with Adam. She's been to the Southeast a couple times this week. And I think she's doing a little better today, but she had several, so she's really doing her best and stuff.
I knew they said she had a UTI and all of her head to the
keyboard. She said today that she was having brain seizures and that she goes for an MRI and a few other things to try to see what's going on.
She's really in the place, so she needs our prayer, and I know Daniel was a good prayer. Let's remember that, Mary Catherine, that we had a service for her, I think Friday night, they have visitation at Gilmore Glen, and Saturday, they have a service there. I think Brother Ken, or Harrison, or Chris Carroll, so, don't remember that. Also, yeah, how about Joel and Paul, did they get?
They get a lot better, and, Dr. Tullock, she got bad cough. She said she may have that through football.
I have heard that out of a number of people. She called the nurse, they said she had that sign.
She, they got a lot better.
Let's keep praying, get that strength back. Ronald Harrison, let's keep praying for him, that cancer, living his God, and her no other day. Jerry McGowan.
He got to come home yesterday evening late, but he ain't doing very good.
Appreciate your prayer.
Just a part failure. They're working on it.
For Leonard and Vicki and their family, they remember them, they know you have done some of the battle routine. That family that's over the Greg Hamilton place, yes, is forever, yes, remember them. So many families, I told them that they come back, small schools here, two parents, so let's remember families, Nita McLean, keep praying for her, for David and Mary Cornett, Charity Knight, David's plumbing, she's battling cancer.
Yeah, I talked to her, she's got that Lyme disease and she can't get her cancer treatment.
So she can't take the treatment. Let's pray for them. The two that was on trial in Finland, that's waiting on their verdict for the 35th. Basically, they're trying to go to prison. Simply, couldn't buy the money. Also, Cody Exon, the young man that battled cancer, and those, Leo Dozier, Wyndham, Dottie Golden, Tevis, Sharon Stoddard, also should like this is pretty out where she's at, getting a stroke, and how do you say that last name?
Becky Farrell.
Becky Farrell. We pray for her. Kevin Strick. If y'all will, the young man that friend that you knew in Tennessee, that's her son-in-law, the tree, calling him, he's cut a tree down, and he just put it in, the butt of it, and he's in very, very tough shape. Just please remember his name, Trey, and I think he's just a man and his wife. Yes, you got him?
Jerry.
They had to do a lot of pancreas in pretty tough shape. Please remember that. Pete Ross, did somebody ask prayer for him?
He's home and bed.
Home and bed?
Yes, he came home yesterday. And he is to walk out of the house.
Let's keep praying for Destiny. That's Destiny. The young lad just mentioned to y'all the other day about Brooklyn that was put for passing on. He was the Lord, keeping up that people, keep up with it. She passed away. She was born. So, it was good to just to see the strength of God gave her to deal with that, but she was young person. Peter's on one. Right for him. Him and Galloway, that is him, they gonna have surgery or something?
Hilton Bird.
Hilton Bird.
Yes, the 29th of March.
I wrote that down, and when I thought myself, it's Hilton Bird.
I appreciate you bragging on it.
Oh, yeah, I know it. You'll be proud of that. Linda McAdams, thank you, sir. And little, Sam Willis. Yeah, she asked prayer for Christmas. She said, she wants to say, she asked prayer. She asked prayer for, for this commemoration, pray for her. And I know we got different needs and all that thing. Is there anyone else who needs to be with us?
Put a mortgage, Deborah Stone. She's halfway through her pregnancy. They're doing good. And also put a Misty and, Cassie. On that paper. Child.
Oh, Misty and,
Cassie.
Cassie. We got three of them. Anyone else? Want to go forward in prayer? Or Gerald, please lead us.
I get turned this time. Father, we thank you for this day, a good day, a beautiful day that you've made. You've allowed us to be part of it, and that's a blessing. Lord, we want to thank you here tonight that we can assemble and gather up. And we just pray, Lord, for each and one that's here tonight. It's like been voiced and the unspoken, and all those in the hospital, the nursing home, our missionaries on the mission field, our military that's scattered all around. And we pray for these, and we pray for our young people in the back there with both Josh and the lady. We ask God that you touch them, that you minister to these young people, Lord, and as Brother Josh and Brother Shane works with them, we send such a breath of fresh air to these young people, and we thank God for that. We're asking you to touch them and minister to these as labor, and be with Brother Larry and Brother Shane as they labor here as pastors and help us along the journey. And Lord, we just pray right now for our community and our town that we live in. We pray, God, that we could see souls saved and lives changed and run into the kingdom of God. And Lord, we pray for these, and we pray for these on our prayer list. And there's many, many, as my brother read them there, Lord, there's many and many more on the prayer list. And we just pray for each one of them, the healing, for the encouragement, for the uplifting, of whatever's needed. God, we're asking you to touch and minister it and bless them in a special way. And Father, we pray for these. We've got some good reports. We've seen some leave out in the past days. And Lord, we're praying for these. That's Lord, just downtrodden and Lord, discouraged along the way. And we pray for these. These that's mourning the lost. We pray for them. Lord, there's lost many in the last 2 or 3 years. And even here in this little community we live in. And we're praying for these children that's left behind and moms and dads. And Lord, just be with them and uplift them in these days and times. And Lord, tonight we pray for our nation. We pray for our country. We pray, God, for our leaders that you might turn their face toward heaven. Heavenly Father, that you might save souls. They're not too much to be saved. I mean, God, they're just they're elected officials and they're human beings and they need salvation.
Yes.
And Lord, they need correction just as we do along this journey down here. And we're praying for them. We're praying, God, that evil one, the enemy that we struggle with from day to day that brings us to the forefront. And Lord, we pray for those people there in Ukraine. We pray to God what we're seeing and hearing out of them, they're beginning to damage their civilians quite a bit and hit them now with those rockets and all those things. And Lord, we're praying for those. They seem to have a lot of courage. They're willing to die for what they believe. They're willing to die to be free. And Lord, what would we say in the situation? Because we may have to one day. But we're praying for these and those that were left in Afghanistan and they're still suffering and they're all around. And we're asking God tonight to catch us, give us a burden to pray for these, a burden to pray and seek the Lord with the whole heart that we might ask for protection and keep and administer. And some of them is getting hungry, Lord, and some of them is having difficulty getting the food in and all these other things. And we're asking God just mercy and grace and strength in the Holy Ghost of God. And tonight we just praise you. We thank you for Oak Grove Missionary Baptist Church.
Yes.
We pray for these that's coming in and out. These that comes on Sunday, Lord, we just pray for each one of them. And we're asking God to just set a course for us that we might look beyond ourselves and see these others that's in need. And Lord, that we be lifted up and pray and seek you and help others as we pass through these days and time. Because we're just passing through. We're just waiting in line, Lord, but thank God we can wait in that assurance and that hope of going to a better place. And God, we want to praise you tonight. We love you. Thank you for allowing us to gather up and be with these that's all around, Lord, that's needed, that we might have missed these, Lord, just right here over the way, Lord, we're praying. God, have mercy on us and strengthen our hearts and encourage us. And Lord, we'll be careful to give you the praise. In Jesus' precious holy name we pray. Amen.